وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Yesterday we spoke about the manhajiyya, the methodology a person needs to take if they want to ground themselves and if they want to have good understanding of madhab al-imam al-shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. And we mentioned 10 things that a person needs to master, or 10 things a person needs to study and learn. But those 10 that we mentioned, we left one behind, we didn't speak about, which was al-furu' al-fiqhiyya, the furu' related issues which are studied in madhab al-imam al-shafi'i. And I said in our last lesson that I would leave this one to the end, inshallah ta'ala, because of its importance and because of its layout and structure. We would need to understand where this book these books started from and how they came about and the history behind these books. So I left al-furu' al-fiqhiyya to the end. And I made a promise last lesson that I would speak about the biography of al-Imam al-Shafi'i in summary. Tarjama wajiza, a very summarized biography of al-Imam al-Shafi'i, and also a summarized biography of al-Imam al-Nawawi, and also a summarized biography of al-Imam al-Rafi'i, Abu al-Qasim al-Rafi'i, rahimahullah. I will speak about those three imams, a summarized, abridged biography of those great scholars. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, the reason why we will speak about his biography is because he's the imam of the madhab. So it's important to know who he is. As for al-Imam al-Rafi'i, Abu al-Qasim al-Rafi'i, and Abu Zakariya al-Nawawi, these two imams have a big place in madhab. They have a big place in the madhab, madhab al-Shafi'i. And we'll study more about them, inshallah ta'ala. ولذلك from the istilahat, from the terminologies that the Shafi'iyya use is al-shaykhan, al-shaykhayn. And when they say al-shaykhayn, the two shaykhs, they are referring to Abu Zakariya al-Nawawi and Abu al-Qasim al-Rafi'i. These are the two scholars that they're referring to. If they say, قال الشيخاني, the two shuyukh said, they are referring to Al-Imam Abu Zakariya al-Nawawi and Al-Imam Abu al-Qasim al-Rafi'i. And we will see what role they both played in the structure and the writing of the madhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Let's first start with the biography of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, the Imam of the madhab. Al-Imam al-Mujtahid, Alim Quraysh. Imam al-Shafi'i was a mujtahid. He reached darajatul ijtihad. He was a scholar, and al-Imam al-Shafi'i was a Qurashiyun. He is a man from Quraysh in terms of his lineage. He's from the four, he's one of the four a'immatul arba'a. The four a'imma that are followed, he's one of the four. The first one is Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, Al-Nu'man ibn Bashir. Al-Nu'man ibn Thabit, sorry. And the second one is Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas. And the third one is Al-Imam Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. And the third one is Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal. So he's one of the four, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. And his name is Muhammad ibn Idris ibn al-Abbas ibn Uthman ibn Shafi' ibn Sa'ib ibn Ubaid ibn Abdi Yazid ibn Hisham Ibn al-Muttalib ibn Abd Manaf. So Imam al-Shafi'i is Muttalibi. Abd Manaf had four kids. One of the kids is al-Muttalib. And the second one is Hashim. The Prophet ﷺ is Hashim. And al-Imam al-Shafi'i is Muttalib. They both come together there. And they both, this is where he and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam come together. Al-Imam Shafi'i's grandfather, Shafi', was a companion. He was a companion. Also, Sa'ib was a companion. Ubaid was a companion. And Abdi Yazid was also a companion. So how many companions were in his lineage, Al-Imam Shafi'i? Four. Shafi', Sa'ib, Ubaid, and Abdi Yazid. Those four were all companions. And they were in the nasab of Al-Imam Shafi'i. They're in the name of Al-Imam Shafi'i. They're his grandparents. Al-Imam Shafi'i was born, rahimahullah ta'ala, he was born in Gaza, which is situated in Palestine, when the year was 150 Hijriya. And he was born, rahimahullah ta'ala, في العام الذي مات الإمام أبو حنيفة. He was born, the year in which Al-Imam Abu Hanifa died. Al-Imam Shafi'i, he was born في العام الذي مات فيه أبو حنيفة. The year in which Abu Hanifa was born, the year Abu Hanifa died, rahimahullah ta'ala, was the year that Al-Imam Shafi'i was born. And some scholars, they took it a step further and they said that Al-Imam Shafi'i, he was born the day in which Al-Imam Abu Hanifa died. And there's no evidence for that, or there's no proof for that. But what is known is that Al-Imam Shafi'i was born the year in which Al-Imam Abu Hanifa died. That's proven and that's correct. Al-Imam Shafi'i, his father died, and his mother raised him. So he grew in his childhood as an orphan. As soon as he was born, not long after, his father passed away. So he was an orphan, and he was brought up in a poor family with his mother. And Imam Shafi'i grew, his upbringing was in Mecca. And he took fiqh from Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zinji. Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zinji was his what? Was his teacher in which he studied with in Mecca. And Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zinji was, he was the mufti of Mecca. And Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zinji, when Imam al-Shafi'i was ibn Khamsa Ashara Sana, when he was 15 years of age, he permitted for him to do fatwa. He said, you're entitled to sit in the haram and you're entitled to give fatwa. So Imam al-Shafi'i at the age of 15, he used to give fatwa. He reached a level to give fatwa. ثم ارتحل إلى المدينة. After that he went to Medina. ولقي الإمام مالك. He met Imam Malik. And he heard from Imam Malik his muwatta. What you have to understand here is that Imam al-Shafi'i, before he took from Imam Malik his muwatta, before he took from Imam Malik his muwatta, he memorized it all. And then when he memorized it, he presented to Imam Malik his mahfudat, what he memorized. And when Imam Malik saw that, he was impressed. So he took from Imam Malik, he heard the muwatta from him. ولذلك he has a riwayah in the muwatta. There are many narrators who narrate from Imam Malik the muwatta. From the people that narrate from him, Imam Malik is Imam Shafi'i. And also Abdullah ibn Maslamah al-Qa'nabi. And also Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi. And others that narrated the muwatta from Imam Malik. From those people is Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, who narrated from him. After that, Imam Shafi'i, he went to Yemen. After he went to Medina and he met Imam Malik, he went and he traveled to Yemen. And when he went to Yemen, he met over there Umar ibn Abi Salama, who was a student of Imam al-Awza'i. So he took fiqh from him, as he also met Yahya ibn Hassan, who is a student of Al-Layth ibn Sa'ad. And Layth ibn Sa'ad was faqih ahli Misr. He was the faqih, the jurist of the people of Egypt. And he took from him. And Imam al-Shafi'i then went to Baghdad after that. But the way that he went to Baghdad was not on his own choice. And Imam Shafi'i was in Yemen. He was taking knowledge from Umar ibn Abi Salama, who was a student of Imam al-Awza'i, Imam Ahli Sham. Imam al-Awza'i was a jurist of the people of Sham. And he was also taking knowledge from Yahya ibn Hassan, who is the student of Al-Layth ibn Sa'ad. Al-Layth ibn Sa'ad was the jurist of the people of Egypt. Lakin Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, whilst taking knowledge from these two Imams, he was forced to leave Yemen by the Khalifa, the leaders, the Abbasi Dawla. They heard rumors that Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was uprising and he was causing a fiasco. He was causing a demonstration. He was causing protest. And he was uprising against the Dawla. So he was forced to come to Baghdad, where the center of the Khilafah was. So he came with the Dawla al-Abbasiyya bringing him, and they placed him on court, al-Imam al-Shafi'i. And when they placed him on court, to see his situation, to revise the situation, ظهرت براءته مما اتهم به. It became clear that Imam Shafi'i was innocent and that wasn't the truth. What was being said wasn't right. And he benefited from that journey. That situation, Imam Shafi'i actually benefited from it. Because he met Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani, rahimahullah. The student of who? The student of Imam Abu Hanifa. And this shows us a benefit that we can take from it, is that hard situations, the tough circumstances, you could sometimes take from it, you can turn it into a good situation. And Imam Shafi'i, as you can see here, he was forced to, rahimahullah ta'ala, go to Baghdad without his choice by the government. They forced him to go there. He's probably going to be arrested and etc. But what did he do with that situation? When his innocence became apparent and clear, he benefited from that opportunity. How did he benefit from it? He benefited by using that journey to study from Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. And he read books on him, and they discussed issues of fiqh, and al-Imam al-Shafi'i benefited greatly from him. Then al-Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, he went back to Mecca where he came from originally, and he remained there. He remained there for 9 years. Those 9 years, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, he would give fatwa, he would teach, rahimahullah ta'ala, وَيَلْتَقِي بِالْعُلَمَاءِ, and he would meet the scholars. Hajj is one of the opportunities and the chances to meet the scholars. So he would meet the scholars. After that, he went to Baghdad for the second time, and he stayed there for 2 years. Then he came back to Mecca, then he turned back to Baghdad on the third occasion. This was the year 198, he came to Baghdad. And he stayed there, rahimahullah ta'ala, months. So when Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, this time he came to Baghdad, rahimahullah ta'ala, he saw the division that was present amongst the fuqaha of Baghdad. And at that time, the fuqaha were divided into two. There were the people known as Ahlul Ra'i, and there were the people known as Ahlul Hadith. And Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, he was very concerned about this situation. But Al-Imam Ahmad has a very famous statement. He said, مَا زِلَّا نَلْعَنُ أَهْلَ الرَّأِي وَيَلْعَنُونَنَا حَتَّى جَاءَ الشَّافِعِيُّ فَمَزَجَ بَيْنَنَا. Al-Imam Shafi'i, before he came to us in Iraq, we used to curse the people of Ra'i, Ahlul Ra'i. And they would curse us as well. Ahlul Ra'i would curse the people of Hadith, and the people of Hadith would curse Ahlul Ra'i. We would curse each other. حتى جاء الشافعي until Al-Imam Shafi'i said, came, until Al-Imam Shafi'i came, فمزج بيننا, and he united us. He brought us together. So Al-Imam Shafi'i brought together Ahlul Ra'i, and he also brought Ahlul Hadith together. ولذلك Al-Imam Shafi'i came to one of the masajids in Iraq, and he saw the people divided in the masjid, and he said, Inshallah ta'ala, Allah will unite these people together under me. And it happened that they all came together under Imam Shafi'i. They all united to study with Imam Shafi'i. وَلِذَلِكَ the way that he united them was, he authored a science known as Usul al-Fiqh. This is how he united them. He authored a science known as Usul al-Fiqh. He wrote a kitab known, Kitab al-Risala. First of all, he united them practically, physically he united them. And then when he united them, Abdulrahman ibn Mahdi, his teacher, Shafi'i's teacher, Abdulrahman ibn Mahdi said to Shafi'i, what you have done by uniting Ahlul Ra'i with Ahlul Hadith, why don't you document it, how you've united them? Meaning the sciences that you've used to unite them requires documenting, which is known as Usul al-Fiqh. So what he did was he authored Usul al-Fiqh, which was the first book written in this science, Usul al-Fiqh. وَأَوَّلُ مَنْ صَنَّفَ وَأَوَّلُ مَنْ أَلَّفَ فِي الْكُتْبِ مُحَمَّدِ ابْنُ شَافِعِ الْمُطَّلِبِ وَغَيْرُهُ كَانَ لَهُ سَلِيقَ مِثْلُ الَّذِي لِلْعُرْبِ مِنْ خَلِيقَ. The first person who wrote was Al-Imam al-Shafi'i in this science, Usul al-Fiqh. And he wrote this kitab, Al-Risala. The Risala, there was an old version and there was a new version. We have the new version of Al-Risala. The old version is nowhere to be found. And it is with the tahqiq of Ahmed Shakir, rahimahullahu ta'ala. But now there's a new one that came out with Mahir al-Fahl. Mahir Yasir al-Fahl. He now done tahqiq of the kitab al-Risala by Imam al-Shafi'i. And I think Mullah Ali Qari has a sharh on the al-Risala by Imam al-Shafi'i. Ala kulli hal, Imam al-Shafi'i united those two madrasas, Madrasatu Ahli al-Hijaz and Madrasatu Ahli al-Iraq. Madrasatu Ahli al-Hijaz is known as what? Ahlul Hadith. And the Madrasatu Ahli al-Ra'i are known as the people of Iraq. So Shafi'i united them, rahimahullah ta'ala. And the factors that helped Imam Shafi'i to unite them was the fact that he took from both of them. Shafi'i studied and he learned from Ahlul Ra'i. Who did he take from? Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, who were the students of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. And he also took from the great Imam, Al-Imamu Malik ibn Anas, rahimahullahu ta'ala, who was a great scholar of Ahlul Hadith. So here Ahlul Hadith, he has Imam Malik, and Ahlul Ra'i, he has Al-Imam Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. So here he had the opportunity to study and learn from both. And so Shafi'i united the concept of ta'zim al-nusus, the veneration, the glorification of the textual evidence, the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and the usage of al-ra'i, opinion, when there's no textual evidence for the issue. So the concept of al-qiyas came into place, and ta'lilat al-masail. Shafi'i applied it from Ahlul Ra'i. ولذلك Ahlul Hadith, prior to Shafi'i, if they were asked questions and there was no textual evidence, they would say Allahu A'lam, but they would leave it. And if they were told, but what is the opinion in this issue? They would say, for instance, like Ahmed and others, Ishaq, they would say, before Shafi'i came, they would say Allahu A'lam, and they would not respond to it. And if they were asked, what about your opinion? And he would say, if I change my opinion tomorrow, because of, and where would I find you? Where can I tell you that I've changed my opinion? So they were against the idea of al-ra'i opinion, the Ahlul Hadith. Whereas Ahlul Ra'ina, they were weak in terms of Hadith. So they were using ta'lilat and they were using qiyas when there were textual evidences present. because of the fact that they were low in hadith. So Ahlul Hadith were criticizing Ahlul Ra'i by speaking before any evidence. They were saying that you're talking and you're jumping in front of the evidences. Because the qa'idah is l'ijtihada bi mawridin nas. You can't do ijtihad when there are textual evidences. These Ahlul Ra'i, they were doing ijtihad with no evidences. And the Ahlul Hadith were having evidences. But Ahlul Ra'i were criticizing Ahlul Hadith by saying, this issue you and I both know there's no evidence for it, but we can use qiyas. Why don't you want to use qiyas? Ahlul Hadith were saying that we shouldn't. Like when Shafi'i came, he brought this together, he united them, and this is where the size of usul al-fiqh came, which is the relationship between the dalil and the madlul. Al-Imam Shafi'i had, we're going to go into it later, a bit more details. Like Al-Imam Shafi'i, he had two aqwal, two views. A view known as, the scholars, they call it Qawlul Qadim, the old opinion of Imam Shafi'i. And the second one is Qawlul Jadid, the new opinion of Al-Imam Shafi'i. The Qawlul Qadim of Al-Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, how do we recognize it from his Qawlul Jadid? The scholars, they say the way to recognize it is, who are the ones who are transmitting that speech of his? If the people who are transmitting his speech are Ahmad ibn Hanbal, for example, Abu Thawr, Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, Ishaq ibn Rahuya. This is an indication that this is the Qawl al-Qadim. This is his old opinion because these are the people of Ahl al-Iraq. And Imam Ahmad took from him whilst Imam Shafi'i was in Iraq. Abu Thawr took from him while he was in Iraq. Al-Imam al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani took from him while he was in Iraq. And Ishaq ibn Rahuya took from him while he was in Iraq. Whereas, if the speech of Imam Shafi'i is transmitted by Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzari, for instance, Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti, Musa ibn Abil Jarud, Allahul Musta'anu ala ma tasifun, if they transmit it, this is an indication that this is the Qawlul Jadid, his new opinion about Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi the fourth. So if Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti, and Musa ibn Abil Jarud, if they transmit the statement of an Imam al-Shafi'i, this is the Qawlul Jadid. This is what? His new opinion. But those who say that an Imam al-Shafi'i, he changed his view when he came to Egypt, was because of the bi'a and the environment that he saw in Egypt, and this is why he changed his opinion, this is invalid and this is not correct. He didn't change it because of the environment that he saw. He changed it, rahimahullah ta'ala, because of evidences that reached him that he didn't see before, which now changed his istidlal. Okay, and things that he saw, the way he saw, now he saw it differently in terms of the evidences and what he came across. And the person's knowledge evolves and it grows. Al-Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he died when the Islamic calendar was 204. So if he was born 150 and he died 204, that makes Al-Imam Shafi'i only 54 years of age. And that shows you, subhanAllah, with that young age, only 54 years. And he has one of the biggest madhabs. His madhab is spread in Egypt. Okay? It's also spread in the Horn of Africa, Somalia and countries like that, and Ethiopia and countries like that. He's spread in Kurdistan, spread in Sharq Asia, also, which is Malaysia, Indonesia, and also in some places of what's it called, India. They're not Ahnaf, they're Shafi'iyya. His madhab is spread, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. And he was only 54 years of age. Allah placed barakah in his time. So that's a summary of the biography of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Now we're going to speak about the biography of Al-Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. Now we're going to start, inshallah ta'ala, the biography of Al-Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Imam An-Nawawi, his name and his kunya is Abu Zakariya Muhyiddin ibn Yahya ibn Sharaf ibn Murri ibn Hassan ibn Hussein ibn Muhammad ibn Jum'at ibn Hizam An-Nawawi thumma Dimashqi. Al-Imam An-Nawawi, his kunya is Abu Zakariya. He had no children. Al-Imam An-Nawawi had no children. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. He had no children. Never got married in his entire life. His name is, his laqab, his nickname is Muhyiddin. His name is Yahya, and his father's name is Sharaf, and his granddad's name is Murri. Al-Imam An-Nawawi is from Nawa. And then after that, he's Dimashqi. This is where he resided in Damascus. Al-Imam An-Nawawi was born in the last 10 days of Muharram, when the year was 631 Hijriyah. That's when he was born. And he was born in Nawa. Al-Imam An-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he read the Quran, and he never reached 19 years of age when he had memorized the Quran, finished the Quran, and his father brought him to Dimashq when he was 19 years of age. He finished the Quran and he memorized great books. And the year that his father brought him to Dimashq was the year 649. And he stayed there in a madrasa known as Madrasatu Al Umariyyah. He stayed there for 2 years. It was said that لَمْ يَضَعْ جَنْبَهُ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ Nawawi, for those 2 years, he never slept on a mattress. He never slept on something. He slept sitting down. For 2 years, he used to sleep sitting down. At this time, he memorized the Kitab At-Tanbih li Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi. He memorized it in 4 months. And he memorized Rub' al-Muhaddab in the remaining part of the year. 4 months. How many months is left after, if you subtract 4 months from 12? You're left with how much? Taqriban, you're left with 8 months. Those 8 months, Al-Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, he memorized the ruba' of the Muhaddab of Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. Some scholars, they said, in 3 months he memorized the tanbih. And 9 months he memorized the rub' of al-Muhaddab. This was in those 2 years when he was in Madrasat al-Rawahiyah. When the year was 651, he did Hajj with his father and he stayed in Medina for 1 month and a half. Then he came back to Nawa. Al-Imam An-Nawawi ijtama'a lahu al-wara'. He was a person who was known for excessive wara'. Wara' meaning he stayed away from anything doubtful. That which was not present for anyone of his time. فَكَانَ لَا يَأْكُلُ مِن فَوَاكِهِ دِمَشْقِ He didn't used to eat from the fruits of Dimashq. It was said that the fruits of Dimashq was fruits, the fruits of Dimashq were fruits that people used to export to other countries. Dimashq was known for its fruits. Dimashq was known for what? It was known for its fruits. Al-Imam An-Nawawi chose not to eat from it. The reason is because the gardens of Dimashq, the things that were said about it, shubah regarding it, he stayed away from it. Doubts that was regarding the gardens of he left it. And he would only eat once a day, and he would wait for his father to send him that meal from Nawa rahimahullah ta'ala. He would eat ba'd Isha al-Akhir, the last night, last part of the night, he would eat rahimahullah ta'ala. He was a person who was known to protect his time, and he would take a lot of care of his time. He wouldn't let anyone waste his time from him. The way that he was known was that if anybody came to visit him, to talk to him, he would say to that person, okay, do you want to ask me something? Okay, sharpen this pencil for me. Sharpen the pen that I want to use for my books. And he would speak to the person in that time. wanting to benefit from the opportunity that work is put into his work is being done, and not to just sit there and do nothing. He used to look after his time so much so that he would study 12 subjects a day, rahimahullahu ta'ala. And these lessons were explanations, correction of his works, rahimahullahu ta'ala. If anybody visited him, he would only let them ask him questions, and if they wanted to socialize with him, he would say, I have no time. If the person wouldn't leave him, and he didn't have anything, and he had nothing to say to them, he would give them a book and he would say, read. He would give the person a book and he would say, read. Nawawi was known for كثير المراقبة لله عز وجل. He would be a person who knew Allah عز وجل is observing him في حركاته وسكناته, in his movements, in the way he was. That's how he was, رحمه الله تعالى. ولذلك, if you look at Imam Nawawi, a lot of his books, غلبه الزهد والورع, you see in his books, a lot of the times he talks about the concept of zuhd and wara and taqwa and أعمال القلوب, actions of the heart. Even then, he was a faqih. He was a jurist. ولذلك الإمام السيوطي, he says, he was a muharrir al-madhab. He was the one who did tahrir of the madhab. He corrected and he organized and he got to the bottom of the madhab. He reached a level, rahimahullahu ta'ala. He was praised by Suyuti and al-Imam al-Wasiti and others, they praised him. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, he wrote many books. He was only 45 years of age when he died. But he left for us what? Taraka turathan ilmiyan fi mukhtalif al-ulum. He left many, 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 many different sciences for us. And he wrote many books. For example, he wrote a kitab called Riyadu Salihin. He wrote a kitab called Al-Arba'in al-Nawawiyyah, 40 hadiths. They have 42 hadiths in there. He wrote a kitab called At-Taqrib fi ulum al-Qur'an, fi ulum al-Hadith. He wrote a book in Mustalah al-Hadith. He wrote another kitab called Rawdatu al-Talibin, which we will touch on inshallah ta'ala, which is a sharp summary of the Fath al-Aziz by Imam al-Rafi'i. They summarized that Imam al-Nawawi. He called it Rawdatu al-Talibin wa Umdatu al-Muftin, rahimahullah ta'ala. He wrote another kitab called Minhaj al-Talibin wa Umdatu al-Muftin, which we will speak about as well inshallah ta'ala, which is originally taken from the Muharrar of Imam al-Rafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala. At-Tibyan fi Adami Hamalat al-Qur'an, where he talks about the manners and the etiquettes of the one who's carrying the Qur'an. He has nukat on the tanbih of Imam al-Shirazi. He has sharh of Sahih Muslim. He has a kitab called Talaqat al-Shafi'iyya. He has a kitab called Tahdhib al-Asma' wal-Lughat. He has another kitab called Daqa'iq al-Minhaj. He has a kitab called Manasik al-Kubra, Manasik al-Sughra. All of those books I mentioned, those 13 books, they are published and they are complete. There are some who are books that he wrote, lakin he didn't complete them. For example, he done a sharah on the kitab Al-Muhaddab al-Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi, which he called Al-Majmu'. Okay? He died at the point of Al-Riba, the chapter of Al-Riba. He didn't complete it. Here's another kitab called Al-Tahqiq. He reached to what? Kitab al-Musafir. There's another kitab called Muhimmat al-Ahkam, and he reached Taharat al-Thawb wal-Badan, the purification of the clothing and the body. There's another kitab called Sharh al-Wasit, the Wasit of Muhammad al-Ghazali, Hujjat al-Islam. He reached towards Shurut al-Salah. And Imam al-Nawawi died on a Wednesday, Al-Rabi'u al-Ishreen, the 24th of the month of Rajab, when the year was 676, and in that morning he was buried in Nawa. Now we're going to go into the third Imam's biography, and that is Al-Imam Abu al-Qasim al-Rafi'i al-Qazwini. Al-Imam al-Rafi'i, the third Imam, whose biography we need to take. Abu al-Qasim al-Rafi'i, he was born, rahimahullah ta'ala, when the Islamic calendar was 555. And he died when it was 623. Al-Imam Al-Rafi'iyu, rahimahullah ta'ala, was an imam who combined between the knowledge of fiqh and the knowledge of hadith. And we'll see that inshallah ta'ala when we speak about his kitab, Fathul Aziz. Al-Imam Al-Rafi'i was born in Qazwin. Qazwin is one of the mudun in Asbahan. One of the cities in Asbahan. That's where he was born. Lakin he was a Arab. He was an Arab. He wasn't an Ajam. He wasn't a foreigner. Rahimahullah ta'ala. And he's from the Kibar A'lam Shafi'iyya. He's from one of the senior, most respected scholars of the Shafi'i Madhab, Al-Imam Al-Rafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. Walidhalika, the Shafi'iyya, they give importance to the view of Al-Imam Abu al-Qasim Al-Rafi'i and the view of Al-Imam Al-Nawwi. Walidhalika, fa'idha utliqa lafdhu al-shaykhayn. If this term al-shaykhayn is used, you know that in the Shafi'iyya, according to the Shafi'iyya, they mean by that who? أريد بهما الرافعي أن يحيى بن شرف النووي. It's meant by الإمام الرافعي and الإمام النووي رحمه الله تعالى. الإمام الرافعي he is known as الرافعي. Like this name الرافعي. And they say that this word رافع, where does it come from? Some of the scholars, they said it's Ahad Ajdadi, is one of his grandparents' name. And others, they say that it originated from the name of the companion Rafi' ibn Khadij. Rafi' ibn Khadij, who was a companion, it was his great-great-great-great-great-great-granddad, rahimahullah ta'ala, al-Imam al-Rafi'iyu. This is where his name is attributed to. Al-Imam al-Rafi'iyu kana mutadalli'an fi funun al-ilm. He's a person who really studied the different sciences. Rahimahullah ta'ala. ولذلك, he used to have a majlis in Qazwin where he would go through fiqh and tafsir and hadith. And he would go through seerah and other things. He has many books, rahimahullah ta'ala. There's a kitab called Fathul Aziz, which is a sharh of al-wajiz lil-ghazali, which we'll speak about inshallah ta'ala. He has another kitab called Sharh al-Saghir. He has al-Muharrar. He has Musnad al-Shafi'i, which is explained. Al-Tadween, al-Amali, rahimahullah ta'ala. He died in Qazwin in the month of Dhul-Hijjah, and he was buried the year when it was 623 Hijriya. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. So in summary, we've taken the three great imams of this madhab. The first one being Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i, and the second one being Al-Imam Al-Nawi, and the third being Al-Imam Al-Rafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala. So it's necessary that the student of knowledge in the Shafi'i madhab, he knows the biography of these three imams, and more than the rest, of course. And also, that the person, he knows the books that they've written. Without further ado, inshallah ta'ala, I want to now go into the tasalsul, the order that the kutub al-madhhab al-shafi'i came about. Remember, we left the furu' al-fiqhiyya to the end. I want to now speak about how did the kutub al-shafi'iyya come about. The furu' al-fiqhiyya I'm talking about. The books, the fiqh books of madhhab al-imam al-shafi'i. What you need to know is, al-imam al-shafi'i, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i authored two books. And those two books are narrated from him, rahimahullah ta'ala, in Furu' al-Fiqhiyya, of course. The first one is Al-Imla'. It's a kitab that was narrated from him by his student, Musa ibn Abil Jarud. He was the one who narrated it from him. This kitab, Al-Imla', is it mafqood or is it makhtoot? I don't know. But Bayhaqi transmits from him in his madkhal. And other fuqaha Shafi'iyya, they transmit from him. And Imam Shafi'iyya, they transmit this book through their works. This book, Al-Imla', we don't have. Whether it's mafqood, it's lost, or whether it's makhtood, it's out there, but it's not published yet, I don't know. Okay? That's the first one. The second kitab is Okay, the is also a kitab from the kutub of Imam Shafi'i, narrated him to him from him by his student Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi. Okay, Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi. These two books are both from the Madhab al-Jadid, Abad al-Qawl al-Jadid, from his new opinions. The Kitab al-Imla and also the Kitab al-Umm, both of them. Lakin, the question here is, the Kitab al-Umm and al-Kitab al-Imla, how do we strengthen one from the other? These are not issues that we want to discuss right now. And which of those two views, if he mentions something in his Imla and what he mentions in his and how to do tarjih, this is another discussion. All that we need to know for now is that the Imla and the both of them are from the Qawl al-Jadid. These are new opinion. Al-Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. And also, there are two other books that were authored by his other students, which is his the Mukhtasar al-Muzani, Sulaiman ibn Yahya al-Muzani, Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, and Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti rahimahullah, Mukhtasar al-Buwayti. Those four books are all the views and the opinions of Imam al-Shafi'i. Those books, the of Imam al-Shafi'i, and the Mukhtasar al-Muzani, Al-Imam Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni summarized it in his kitab Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayat al-Madhab. So the kitab of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i and the Mukhtasar al-Imam al-Muzani rahimahullah Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, both of them got summarized by who? Both of them got summarized by Al-Imam Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni rahimahullah ta'ala in his kitab Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayat al-Madhab. This kitab Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayat al-Madhab is 20 volumes with the Fahras, the content page. I'm basing on the Darul Minhaj, the Taba' of Darul Minhaj, which is the Tahqiq of Abdul Azim al-Deep. This one is 20 volumes with the Fahras. Fahras is one volume and 19 volumes is the what? Is the book. As for the of an Imam al-Shafi'i, the best taba'a, the best publication for it is Darul Wafa, I'm a Dar ibn Hazm. And it's with the tahqiq of tahqiq of Rif'at al-Fawzi. Rif'at al-Fawzi's tahqiq of al-Umm is the best so far. He published the with the Risala, with all of it, it's there. And he published it with 11 volumes. As for the Mukhtasar of Al-Imam Al-Muzani was also, look at it, I said the by Imam Shafi'i and the Mukhtasar of Al-Imam Al-Muzani, both of them got summarized in which book? Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayat al-Madhab. By who? Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni. Which publication? Darul Minhaj. Which Muhaqqiq? Abdul Azim al-Deeb. How many volumes? 20 volumes. With the Fahras, it's 20 volumes. Lakin the Mukhtasar al-Muzani by itself, the Mukhtasar al-Muzani by itself was summarized in the book known as Al-Hawi al-Saghir. Many people, they confuse Hawi al-Kabir and Hawi al-Saghir. Al-Hawi al-Kabir is the summary of the Mukhtasar al-Muzani. This is very important that you know that. Hawi al-Kabir, which is written by Al-Bawardi, which we'll speak about inshaAllah ta'ala, is a summary of, it's a summary of the Kitab Mukhtasar al-Imam al-Muzani rahimahullah ta'ala by al-Imam al-Bawardi rahimahullah ta'ala. As for the Hawi al-Saghir is a Mukhtasar of the Fath al-Aziz by al-Imam al-Rafi'i. It's very important that you know the difference. The Mukhtasar al-Muzani we mentioned, it's only one volume And the Hawil Kabir is like a mukhtasar, and it's also an explanation. And Imam Al-Mawardi, Abu Hassan Ali ibn Muhammad Al-Mawardi, who died in 450, he explained the mukhtasar al-Muzani as well in that kitab Al-Hawil Kabir. Let's go under Al-Umm. What did we say was summarized? Who summarized the Umm and the mukhtasar al-Muzani? Al-Imam Abi Mu'ali al-Juwayni in his kitab Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayatil Madhab. Then Abi Hamid al-Ghazali came and he summarized the Nihayatul Matlab. Hafidh ibn Hajar doesn't agree with that. That Abu Hamid al-Ghazali had summarized the kitab Nihayatul Matlab in his book Al-Basit. Abu Hajar doesn't agree to that. But other scholars, they say that the kitab Al-Basit by Abi Hamid al-Ghazali is a summary of the Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayatil Madhab. Written by who? Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad. Al-Ghazaliyu, known as Hujjatul Islam. That kitab is around 8 volumes, taqriban. The book that then summarized Al-Basit of Al-Imam Al-Ghazali is the Wasit that he wrote. Al-Imam Al-Ghazali, he himself, he summarized his Basit into Al-Wasit. In 9 volumes, he summarized it. And the best daba'a is Darul Bashair Al-Islamiyya with the tahqiq of Ali Muhyiddin. And it's 9 volumes. The Kitab Al-Wasit. Abi Hamid Al-Ghazali, on a third attempt, he summarized. So the first one, he summarized the Nihaya into Al-Basit. And then he summarized the Basit into Al-Wasit. And then he summarized the Al-Wasit into the Al-Wajiz. He summarized the Al-Wasit into Al-Wajiz. Al-Imam Abi Hamid Al-Ghazali. The Wajiz is 2 volumes. And the best, or the I wouldn't say the best because I don't know, I never compared it. But the publication that I have personally is the Taba'a of Dar al-Arqam with the tahqiq of Ali Mu'awad or Adil Abdul Majud. Abdul Mawjud. Adil Abdul Mawjud. That's the Taba'a I have. So now we have 4 books that came from Al-Imam Shafi'i. The first one is Al-Imla. The riwayah is who? Musa ibn Abi al-Jarud. Al-Umm, which is the riwayah of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi. The Mukhtasar of Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani. And the Mukhtasar of Al-Buwayti as well, Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti. Those 4 are all the aqwal and the views and the statements of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. So it's not wrong to attribute all 4 to Imam Shafi'i. To say that these are Imam Shafi'i, his works. Al-Imam Al-Mawardi Abu al-Hasan, he summarized, he died in 450 Hijriya, he summarized and he explained the Mukhtasar al-Imam al-Muzani and he called it Al-Hawil Kabir. Al-Imam Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni summarized the and also the Mukhtasar al-Muzani in his kitab Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayat al-Madhab, 20 volumes. And then Al-Imam Abi Hamid Al-Ghazali, who's the student of Al-Imam Abi Ma'ali Al-Juwayni, he summarized the Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayatil Madhab in the Basit, which is 11 volumes. And then the Basit got summarized into Al-Wasit, which is 9 volumes, Darul Bashair Al-Islamiyya, 9 volumes. Who summarized it? Abi Hamid Al-Ghazali himself. And then he summarized his Al-Wasit again into Al-Wajiz, which is 2 volumes, the Taba'a being Dar Al-Arqam. Now, at this point, Al-Imam Abi Hamid Al-Ghazali felt the need to summarize his Al-Wajiz again. Again. On the what? On the 4th attempt. 4th summarization. And he called it Al-Khulasa, which is the long name is Khulasatul Mukhtasar وَنَقَاوَةُ الْمُعْتَصِرِ مُعْتَصَر 1 volume. Darul Minhaj published it with the tahqiq of Amjad Rashid Muhammad Ali. This is 1 volume and it's matbu', it's mutadawal, it's present. Lakin the best summarization of Al-Wajiz that the Shafi'iyya sat with was the summarization of Al-Imam Al-Nawawi rahimahullah. Al-Imam Al-Nawawi summarized the Al-Wajiz. So we have 2 people who summarize Al-Wajiz. The author himself, Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali, He summarized the wajiz into al-khulasa. And al-imam Abi Zakariya al-Nawawiyyu summarized al-wajiz into al-minhaj, which is known as minhaj al-talibin wa umdat al-muftin. The best taba'a we said is the dar al-minhaj is the best taba'a for the minhaj. Then the minhaj got summarized by Zakariya al-Ansari rahimahullah. He didn't only just summarize the book, but he actually summarized the name. The kitab was known as Minhaj al-Talibin, so he called it Manhaj al-Tulab. Zakariya al-Ansari rahimahullah. The best taba'a that I've seen was Darul Ilmiyyah with the tahqiq of Salah ibn Muhammad. Then Zakariya al-Ansari's kitab, Manhaj al-Tulab, got summarized into Nahj al-Talab by Al-Jawhari. So we have here the wajiz of Al-Imam Al-Rafi'i rahimahullah. It got summarized into what? It got summarized, the wajiz, by two people. One, the author himself, Al-Imam Al-Ghazali, he called it Khulasa. And also, Al-Imam Al-Nawi summarized Al-Wajiz into what? Minhaj al-Talibin wa Umdat al-Muftin. The best taba'a that we said is which one? Taba'a of Darul Minhaj. That's the best taba'a. And it's only one volume. Pay attention here. Al-Imam Al-Nawi's Minhaj, the scholars, they said it has 60 masail. 24 of those masail are masail mantuqa, direct masail that Nawi brings out. And there are the remaining, to complete it, to make it 60,000, is masail al-mafhuma from the kitab, understood from the kitab. In total, there are 60,000 masail fiqhiyya far'iyya in this kitab Minhaj. Scholars loved it. They sat with this book and they gave it a lot of attention. Then Al-Imam Zakariya al-Ansari came and he summarized the Minhaj of Al-Imam al-Nawi. What did he summarize it into? He summarized the name. It was called Minhaj al-Talibin wa Umdat al-Muftin. He summarized it into what? Manhaj al-Tulab. And then Al-Jawhari came and he summarized the Zakariya al-Ansari's kitab and he called it Nahj al-Talab. He called it Nahj al-Talab. All of these books that I'm mentioning are published and they are out there. Let's go back to the kitab Al-Wajiz. Okay? The Wajiz by Imam Al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala. The Wajiz by Imam Al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala, it got summarized. Okay? Who did I say summarized it? Al-Imam Al-Nawawi. Here there's a khilaf amongst the scholars. Okay, and I need to mention this, which is the Kitab Al-Minhaj. Is it taken directly from the Al-Wajiz or is it taken from the Muharrar of Al-Imam Al-Rafi'i? This is an issue. The qawl which is Mu'tamad, the strongest opinion, is that the Minhaj of Al-Imam Al-Nawawi is taken from the Muharrar of Al-Imam Al-Rafi'i. So it's, instead of saying that the Muharrar of, instead of saying the Al-Wajiz, Minhaj was taken from the Wajiz, we can say that the Minhaj is taken from the Muharrar and the Muharrar was taken from the Wajiz. So how is it? The kitabs are like this. It's the Kitab Al-Umm and the Mukhtasar Al-Muzani. Under it is Nihayatul Matla fi Dirayatil Madhab. And from the Nihayatul Matla fi Dirayatil Madhab is the Al-Basit by Imam Al-Ghazali, and then the Al-Wasit by Imam Al-Ghazali, and then the Al-Wajiz by Imam Al-Ghazali. And from the Wajiz came two books. The Khulasa by Imam Al-Ghazali himself, and the Muharrar by Imam Al-Rafi'i. And from the Muharrar came out the Kitab Minhaj al-Talibin wa Umdat al-Muftin. And Al-Imam al-Rafi'i, what he did was he summarized the Wajiz into Muharrar and he also explained the Wajiz. So he summarized, what did he summarize? He summarized the wajiz, and he also explained the wajiz. The summary of the wajiz is the muharrar, and the explanation of the wajiz is the Fathul Aziz. They say that he called it originally what? He called it originally Al-Aziz, and scholars didn't like it, so they put the name Fath before it, because Al-Aziz is only for the Book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And then the Muharrar, then the Minhaj came from it, and then the Minhaj of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, Zakariya al-Ansari summarized it into Manhaj al-Tulab, and then Jawhari summarized it into Nahj al-Talab. That's how we have it. Another view says, no, Minhaj is actually taken from what? It's taken from the Al-Wajiz. Lakin that view is qawl, which is marjuh. The reason why it's marjuh, and the reason why I mentioned that qawl at the beginning, was because it's the weaker of the two. The view that's strongest is that the Kitab Minhaj al-Talibin is taken from the Muharrar. لأن النووي mentions it in the Muqaddimah of his Kitab al-Minhaj. He mentions it in the Muqaddimah. So here we have that order. So we have four books that the Shafi'iyyah stand on. The first one is Al-Imla, and we have the and we have Abu Ya'qub al-Buwaiti's Kitab, his Mukhtasar, and we have the Muzani's Mukhtasar. So we have Al-Imla and and the third we have is Mukhtasar al-Buwaiti and the Mukhtasar of Imam al-Muzani, rahimahullah. The Mukhtasar of Imam al-Muzani and the of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, summarized by who? Al-Imam Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni in his great book, Nihayat al-Matlab fi Dirayat al-Madhab, 20-volume book, with the publication of Darul Minhaj. Abi Hamid al-Ghazali came and he summarized the Nihayat al-Matlab into Al-Basid. And then he summarized the Basid into Al-Wasid. And then he summarized the Wasid into Al-Wajiz. And then he summarized the Al-Wajiz into Al-Khulasa. And Al-Imam al-Rafi'i also summarized the Al-Wajiz into Muharrar. Nawawi summarized the Muharrar into Al-Minhaj. And Zakariya al-Ansari summarized the Al-Minhaj into Manhaj al-Tulab. And then Al-Jawhari summarized the Manhaj al-Tulab of Zakariya al-Ansari into Nahj al-Talab. Now let's go back to the Al-Wajiz of Al-Imam al-Rafi'i rahimahullah. The Wajiz of Al-Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah. Al-Rafi'i rahimahullah, he summarized it in his Kitab al-Muharrar. Okay? And he also explained it in his Kitab Fathul Aziz. He summarized it in his Kitab Fathul Aziz. From the Fathul Aziz of Al-Imam al-Rafi'i, Fathul Aziz is a 24-volume book. And the best publication for it is the Ja'izatu Dubai al-Dawliya lil-Qur'an al-Kareem. It published it in 24 volumes. It's amazing. And this Kitab, Fath al-Aziz, Bisharh al-Wajiz, by al-Imam al-Rafi'i, rahimahullah, scholars, they gave it a lot of attention. From the scholars that gave a lot of attention to it is al-Imam ibn Mulaqin. What al-Imam ibn Mulaqin did is, in his kitab al-Badr al-Munir, fi takhrij al-ahadith al-waqi'ah fi sharh al-kabir ibn Mulaqin, he did takhrij of the ahadith in Fath al-Aziz. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he read the Kitab al-Badr al-Munir by his Shaykh Ibn Mulaqin. And what did he do? He summarized it. Al-Imam Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he summarized the Kitab of his Shaykh Ibn Mulaqin, al-Badr al-Munir, because Ibn Mulaqin brings asanid and too much. Ibn Hajar felt the need to summarize it. The book originally called it At-Tamiz. Is a long name, and then he is well known as Talkhis al-Habir. Talkhis al-Habir is a summary of the Kitab al-Badr al-Munir ibn Mulaqin, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So you can see that scholars gave a lot of attention to Fathul Aziz. And al-Imam al-Nawawi, Abu Zakariya al-Nawawi, he actually summarized that book, the Fathul Aziz, by al-Imam al-Rafi'i. He summarized it in the Kitab Rawdatu al-Talibin wa Umdatu al-Muftin. Rawdatu al-Talibin wa Umdatu al-Muftin is a summary of the Kitab Fathul Aziz by Al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. He summarized it. And then his Kitab Rawdatu al-Talibin wa Umdatu al-Muftin, it got summarized by Ibn al-Muqri He summarized into the kitab Al-Rawd. And then Ibn Hajar summarized Al-Rawd into what? Into the kitab Al-Na'im. The Na'im of Ibn Hajar is mafqud. It's not present. It's not found. It's not found. And then the Fath al-Aziz, also a summary that was made from it other than Rawdat al-Talibin, is Al-Hawi al-Saghir. The Hawi al-Saghir by Najmuddin al-Qazwini is a summary of Fath al-Aziz. And so is the Rawdat al-Talibin. Both of them are summary. The best Taba'a is, because it's only one volume book, is Dar ibn al-Jawzi, Risala Ilmiya, was placed on it and it was worked hard on. So we have Rawdatu al-Talibin, which is a summary of what? Summary of Fath al-Aziz. Rawdatu al-Talibin is Rawdatu al-Talibin of Ibn Nawawi is a summary of Fath al-Aziz by Imam al-Rafi'i. And also what is a summary of Fath al-Aziz is the kitab of Imam Najmuddin al-Qazwini, the kitab Hawi al-Saghir. Rawdatu al-Talibin, there are four good hawashi that are placed on it. The hashiya of al-Isnawi, al-Asnawi, however you want to say it. The second one is al-Dhra'i's hashiya on it. The third one is Bulqili's hashiya on it. And the fourth one is Ibn Ibad hashiya on it. Those four hawashi that are placed on Rawdatu al-Talibin wa Umdatu al-Muftin, Badruddin al-Zarkashi, he took it all and he placed it on top of what? His book known as Al-Khadim. The Khadim is a kitab that has the four hawashi of Rawdatu al-Talibin and it has extra benefits of Fath al-Aziz that he mentions in there as well. The four hawashi that I mentioned is Al-Asnawi, Al-Isnawi, however you want to say it, Al-Adra'i, Ibn Imad, and Bulqaini, Bulqini, however you want to say it. Four of those, Badruddin al-Zarkashi, he summarized it and he brought it together in his kitab Al-Khadim. And then from the Hawi al-Saghir by Najmuddin al-Qazwini came the kitab Irshad al-Ghawi ila Masalik al-Hawi by Ismail ibn Abi Bakr ibn al-Muqri. The kitab Irshad al-Ghawi ila Masalik al-Hawi is kitab which is a bit bigger than Minhaj al-Talibin wa Umdat al-Muftin by Nawawi. It has 80,000 masail in there, the Fuqaha Shafi'iyya mentioned. And this kitab, Irshad al-Ghawi, it has in it more masail, and the way that it's written is not easy. The terminologies and the words that are used are not easy. The one that is easy is Minhaj al-Talibin, very easy. And the best publication for Irshad Al-Ghawi ila Masalik Al-Hawi is Daru Minhaj. It's one volume. It's one volume. So let me recap, inshallah ta'ala, for the Tulab al-Ilm who are writing and want to know all of this. The Kutub al-Shafi'iyya, the Tasalsul that we were mentioning all day, I'm going to summarize it in a couple of minutes, inshallah ta'ala. And I'm going to conclude there, inshallah ta'ala, at that point. The Kutub al-Shafi'iyya, they start from four main books. The first one is Al-Imla, the riwaya is Musa ibn Abi al-Jarud. Al-Umm by Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi. The riwaya of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi from Shafi'i. The difference between the Imla and the Umm is that they're from two different students. The Imla is from riwaya Musa ibn Abi al-Jarud and the Umm is from who? The riwaya of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi. The two other books that are written is the Mukhtasar al-Muzani, Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, and the Mukhtasar of Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti. The Mukhtasar of Imam al-Muzani, it's summarized by al-Mawardi, Abu al-Hasan al-Mawardi, who died in 450 Hijriya. He summarized it in his kitab al-Hawi al-Kabir, the Mukhtasar al-Muzani. The Mukhtasar al-Muzani and the Ummah of Imam al-Shafi'i, both of them are summarized in the kitab Nihayatul Matlab ila Dirayatil Madhab by Imam Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni. The best taba'a we mention is Darul Minhaj, and it's 20 volumes, Ma'al Fahras. Al-Imam Abi Hamid al-Ghazali, who is the student of Imam Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni, he summarized Nihayatul Matlab into the book Al-Basit. And we said it's 11 volumes. And then he summarized the Kitab al-Basid into al-Wasid, into 9 volumes. Darul Bashair al-Islamiyah is the best taba'ah. And then the al-Wasid, he summarized it into al-Wajiz. And then the Wajiz, he summarized it into Khulasa. And also al-Rafi'i summarized al-Wajiz. What did he summarize it into? He summarized it into al-Muharrar. And then Nawawi summarized the Muharrar into Minhaj. Zakariya al-Ansari summarized the Minhaj into Manhaj al-Tulab. And then al-Jawhari summarized the Manhaj al-Tulab into Nahj al-Talab. So they didn't just summarize the book, they summarized the name as well. The al-Wajiz that I mentioned by Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, al-Rafi'i didn't only summarize it into his Kitab al-Muharrar. He also explained it in his Kitab Fathul Aziz. He summarized it and he explained it. The Fathul Aziz, Nawawi came to it and he summarized it into the Kitab Rawdatul Talibin. He summarized it into the book Rawdatul Talibin. And the Rawdatul Talibin is a summary of Fathul Aziz, and so is the Hawi al-Saghir. Hawi al-Saghir by who? Najmuddin al-Ghazwini. Najmuddin al-Ghazwini and al-Rawdatul Talibin, both of them are what? Both of them are summary for Fathul Aziz. Irshad al-Ghawi ila Masalik al-Hawi by Ismail ibn Abi Bakr ibn al-Muqri is a summary of Hawi al-Saghir. Okay? And then kitabs came out of Irshad. Rawdatul Talibin, if we go back to it, it has 4 hashiyah placed on it that are very important for a student knowledge to have. Hashiyah of Al-Adra'i, Al-Isnawi, the Hashiyah of Ibn Imad, and the Hashiyah of Bulqini. 4 of those Hawashi, Zarkashi, Badruddin Zarkashi, he placed it in what book? In his Kitab Al-Khadim. Going back to the Kitab Fathul Aziz, where the Rawdatul Talibin and also Al-Hawil Saghir are taken from, that a hadith that are in it that needed to be authenticated, 2 great scholars worked on it. The first one was Al-Badr al-Munir by Ibn Mulaqin. Ibn Mulaqin, he worked on, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a, he worked on the ahadith that are in Fathul Aziz. And then that kitab, Badr al-Munir, because it's very big and it's large in quantity and the narrations and everything that I mentioned are extensive, Ibn Hajar felt there was a need to summarize it. And he summarized it in his kitab, Talqis al-Habir. He summarized it in his kitab, Talqis al-Habir. The kitab of Al-Imam Al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, Rawdatul Talibin, that we mentioned, it got summarized into Al-Rawd by Ibn al-Muqri, and it also got summarized, the Rawd of Ibn al-Muqri got summarized into the Kitab Al-Na'im by Ibn Hajar. Ibn Hajar's Kitab Al-Na'im is mafqood, we don't have it. Some scholars, they said it was mafqood when the author himself was alive, Ibn Hajar, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'a. I then now need to mention, just the last point before I conclude, is Kutubu al-Shirazi. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi's books, where do they come into? Okay? Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi has books that a student of knowledge should try to buy. From those books is his kitab, At-Tabih. It's very important that a student of knowledge, he buys that kitab, At-Tabih. And also his other kitab, which is Al-Muhaddab. His Tabih and his Muhaddab. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi has a miza, has a virtue, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a, which is that which Al-Imam ibn Taymiyyah praised him for. He really was a person who wasn't like the rest of the ulama of his time who indulged too much into ilmul kalam. Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. ولذلك Al-Imam ibn Taymiyyah, he praised the kitab Al-Lub'a by Shirazi in Usul al-Fiqh. He praised it. And it was praised by scholars of the Sunnah even more than the kitab Ghayat al-Usul, which is Lubb al-Usul, which is the Mukhtasar of Jam' al-Jawami' by Zakariya al-Ansari. If you read the kitab Lubb al-Usul, you realize there's a lot of Ash'ariyya and Ilm al-Kalam and etc. in there. Whereas Al-Lum'a by Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi is not like that. It's better in that regard. And there's Hashiya and benefits by Jamaluddin al-Qasimi on there. And Albani rahimahullah done takhrijat on it. The kitab Al-Lub'a by Ishaq al-Shirazi. The second kitab is Muhadhab. The Muhadhab, scholars came together and they explained it. Three scholars, they came together and explained it. The first scholar is Al-Imam al-Nawawi. He died at Kitab al-Riba, as I mentioned. And then Subki took over it. And he died halfway. And after Al-Imam al-Subki, Muhammad al-Najib al-Muti'i, who was a Hanafi, he carried on the book and he finished it. So three scholars came together in the explanation of that book. The first one being Al-Imam al-Nawawi, and then Subki, and then Muhammad Najib al-Muti'i. The Muhadhab of Ishaq al-Shirazi was explained by Al-Imrani in his Kitab al-Bayan as well. The Muhadhab was also explained by Al-Imrani in his Kitab al-Bayan, which is published, Darul Minhaj. Inshallah ta'ala, those are the books and how they came about. What books should a student of the Madhab of Al-Imam Shafi'i study? And which book should he go over? The person should study 5 books in the Madhab al-Imam Shafi'i. The first one is Matn Abi Shuja'. The student of knowledge should do that. And he should study with the Sharh of Ibn Qasim. If he can't, then he should take the Sharh of the Sharh Kifayat al-Akhyar, which I think is the Sharh of al-Husni or al-Hasni, or I can't remember the dhabt of his name. He's one, Kifayat al-Akhyar, if you can't. The second book that you should do is Yaqut al-Nafis. The third kitab that you do is the Zubad by Ibn Raslan. The fourth one you do is Umdatul Salik wa Uddatul Nasik. The Umdatul Salik wa Uddatul Nasik is the summarization and the khulasa of what's in Muharrar and that which is in Minhaj. That's what Ibn Naqib al-Masri did. He took the khulasa and the summary of what is in the Muharrar of Al-Imam al-Rafi'i and the Minhaj, the views. He mentioned that in his Muqaddimah. And the last, the fifth book that the student should do is the Minhaj of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. Those 5 books are the 5 books of the Madhab that the person should study. The rest of the books that I mentioned, the student then can read it himself. He can do mutala'a of it. But these are the barnamij al-dirasa that the student has to study. And the other ones, the other books are mujarrad qira'ah, just mere reading. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.